Okay, so let's start on the astrophysics. Carlo already said that in order to reach a detailed CMB map, you need to remove a lot of components that are in the foreground of the CMB itself. And of course, if on one side these components are a disturbance that you want to remove, from the astrophysical point of view, they are extremely interesting. And this is because Planck discovered a frequency range which is largely unexplored by other experiments, and even in the range in which there are other data, these data do not have the quality of Planck data. They do not have the sky coverage that Planck has, they do not have the angular resolution, do not have the sensitivity from Planck. Therefore, there is a lot of astrophysics that can be extracted from the Planck maps. Now, as already Carlo anticipated, there are so many data coming out that it's impossible to present them in the time that is available today. So I've made some sort of a selection, which is of course biased towards my scientific interests, and therefore I apologize for missing results that may be much more interesting to others. I would like to start linking myself to what was said by Carlo and also by Gigi, that Planck is revealing that the universe is mostly dark. Now, we know that even in the part of the universe which is in principle not dark, it is in principle visible, we know quite little. We know that only about 10% of the normal matter or baryons that we know to exist in the universe shows up in terms of stars and galaxies. About 90% has escaped detection so far. And the reason why it has escaped detection is that we know that this matter must be almost completely ionized and it must have a low density. And the emission from this low density plasma, of course, all emission processes roughly go as the density squared. So if you have a low density, the surface brightness is extremely low and therefore very easily escapes detection. There is, however, a signal that comes from this plasma, but does not go as 10 squared, but simply linearly with the density. And this is the Shunyaev-Zeldovich effect. It is the inverse Compton scattering of CMB photons by the plasma electrons. And this was expected, and this was found to be a much powerful probe than direct emission in order to see the effect of this low-density plasma. The Shunyaev-Zeldovich effect has been measured from the ground on tens of rich clusters of galaxies where the temperature is very high, of the order of 10 or even 100 million degrees. And Planck has improved quite a lot in this. Now we have several hundreds of clusters detected by Planck with the Shunyaev-Zeldovich effect. And the example I'm showing here, which is an observation of the Coma cluster, one of the most famous objects in the sky, we have a comparison between the emission in X-rays, which is the red to white part of the figure, with the emission in the Shunyaev-Zeldovich effect made by Planck, which are the contour levels that are shown there. And what was found in this kind of observations is that the hot gas in the Coma cluster was mapped in the Shunyaev-Zeldovich effect up to radii which are about four times larger than the region that was mapped in X-rays, which means that Planck is able to see hot gas over an area which is about 20 times larger than that was detectable in X-rays, and therefore can see far more of this gas than can be seen in X-rays. And in fact, there are other examples showing that Planck can go even beyond the nominal radii of the clusters. There are some examples in which Planck detects bridges of hot gas connecting a binary cluster system, And there is also an example in the Planck papers of a triple system in which the hot gas is observed to cover the full region occupied by the three clusters of galaxies. Now, we know that this hot gas in cluster of galaxies is an important component of clusters. The mass in the hot gas is larger than the mass in stars and galaxies within the clusters, but on the cosmic scale, the fraction of gas compared to the total baryon mass is low. But the idea was to see whether Planck can do better than that in order to understand how this hot plasma is distributed by looking for a Sunyaev-Zeldovich effect in the direction of much more numerous lower mass objects, therefore in this case bright galaxies. We have Sloan Digital Sky Survey that has provided huge samples of bright galaxies selected in the optical, a sample of 260,000 bright galaxies in the sky have been selected and been divided into 20 bins in stellar mass, and the Planck data were stacked together. Stacking means summing up the signals in the direction of many, many objects, so that even if each individual object is not detected, the sum signal is statistically significant. And in fact, a statistically significant signal was found over quite a substantial range of stellar masses of these galaxies, as you can see from here. And summing up the gas masses associated to these galaxies, it turned out that Planck detected about 25% of these, which are called missing baryons. Baryons that we know to exist, we know they are ionized, but we do not have other means to observe directly. Now, still in the framework of the Planck results of extragalactic sources, here in this figure, which was made by Zenikai, is shown the counts of galaxies at 350 microns in the highest frequency channel of Planck HFI, as determined by Planck, while this bump here in the counts is the one determined by Herschel. So we see a nice complementarity between Planck and Herschel, and we see that Planck is the mission that determines the flat, so in the Euclidean part of the counts, and indeed Planck has determined has built a rich sample of nearby galaxies, and this sample has a specific interest to understand what's going on in the nearby universe as far as the star-forming galaxies are concerned, so to determine, for example, local luminosity function, the dust mass function, the star formation function, and so on, so to understand the star formation in the nearby universe. And of course, has also the importance of determining the baseline counts that then show this very steep increase at fainter flux densities as measured by Herschel. But Planck goes, in fact, well beyond that, in the sense that it's also providing information on these fainter sources over here. And this information is, of course, statistical. Planck cannot detect directly them, with some exception that I will mention briefly. And what Planck does is to detect the effect of these faint sources on the fluctuation field that remains in the data after you have removed the directly detected sources, you have removed the cosmic microwave background. What is left is a highly fluctuating field which contains information on sources which are below the detection limit. And what is found by Planck and also by Herschel is that this fluctuation field shows signs of strong clustering. So the galaxies, these faint galaxies, are strongly clustered. And this is important, for example, that is important for many purposes, but an example shown here, which is based on work that is going into the PhD thesis of one CISA student, Zenikai, is that the clustering part of the power spectrum of the fluctuations, which is this raising part, is a sensitive function of the mass in the dark matter halos that host the galaxies, which are responsible for the cosmic infrared background. Of course, you know that the determining this, the dark matter mass, the mass of the dark matter halos, is something very difficult by any other means. This is one of the means that we do have to understand how the structure in the universe evolved in terms of dark matter, determined from the observational point of view, and to compare that with simulations that are telling us what we expect in the framework of the standard cosmology. And what is interesting, and it is a result presented in this paper here, is that the effective mass of the dark matter halos turned out to be in very good agreement with what is determined from direct observations of galaxies at redshift around 2, and in very good agreement with a specific model that we have been working out with Danese, Andrea Lapi, here at CISA over the years, which is different from other widely used scenarios for galaxy evolution, which tend to predict pretty different halo masses for these galaxies that are responsible for the cosmic infrared background. Another prediction that was made here at CISA in the PhD thesis by Mattia Negrello in 2007 was that this specific model that I've briefly mentioned implies that there is a very strong gravitational lensing effect on faint sources. So we expect a tail of high redshift sources to be detected at much higher fluxes than those of unlensed objects, which are represented here by the dot dashed line. The dot dashed line is the expected counts of unlensed galaxies at, in this case, 1.4 millimeter wavelengths, while the dots here are observed counts of strongly lensed objects, while the green line is an updated prediction of the strongly lensed counts that we expect. And these objects turn out to be a factor of 10 brighter than they should have been without the lensing. Now, the interesting thing in respect to Planck is that the model that feeds the data, so has some credibility, has a tail of strongly lensed objects which goes at flux density level that are not far from those that can be reached by Planck. And this is illustrated here, where there is the comparison shown before between the counts of galaxies by Planck and the model, and you see that the extreme tail of the prediction for strongly lensed objects is marginally at the level at which Planck is able to detect objects. Now, there is another interesting thing here, and in fact, at least two strongly lensed galaxies have been found among the Planck sources detected by Planck. This is one published example in which the central bright object is a strongly lensed galaxy with measured redshift at 3.26 that has been detected in an inertial survey and found to have a counterpart in the Planck catalog. However, the observations that made by Planck indicate a total flux density, which is about 3 times higher than that measured by Herschel. And this can be understood taking into account that this circle here represents the Planck beam. So Planck is collecting signal from a much larger area than that corresponding to the source. And within this much larger area, we have the data indicating that we have some additional contribution from something else. What is this something else? Well, it may be just a random fluctuation, which happens to be associated to the source just by chance. But it may be that there is a physical association. And the physical association may be of two kinds. It may be that there is a clump of dusty galaxies which are related, physically related, in the same region of the sky where also the strongly dense source is. So we have a sort of protoclusters of which the strongly dense object is some signpost. Or it may be that this excess signal comes from dusty galaxies associated to lower redshift, in particular to the galaxies at redshift around 1 that are found to be the lenses that are responsible for this strong amplification. Both at the moment we cannot discriminate between these various possibilities. However, again, in the Matthias Negrello thesis, there was a prediction that this could indeed occur. And the prediction was based on what we know from simulations about the large-scale structure of the universe. We know that the large-scale structure is filamentary. There are regions in which the filaments cross, and these are called nodes. And these nodes are thought to be the regions where rich clusters of galaxies form. So you may have that the strongly dense sources is associated to a node, and therefore it may have a clump of dusty galaxies around it. Or it may be that, for some reason, Planck is observing along the filament. And in this case, what Planck observes is the integral over a much, much larger volume. The second possibility is the more likely one, because otherwise the cluster of galaxies, we have a protocluster of galaxies ratio of 3, it should be really a monster, hardly compatible with the standard model. However, again, this was a prediction made long time ago that has been strongly confirmed by more recent data, and the prediction made here at CISA. There is, I think I am more or less almost out of time, so I finish very quickly to say that there is, again, in the extragalactic region, Planck is also providing samples of blazars. Blazars are these extreme active galactic nuclei that are radio emitting, and the normal usual interpretation is that their emission is Doppler boosted by relativistic electrons that are moving along a jet, and the jet being more or less aligned with our line of sight. Well, the notion that we have is that the host galaxies of the active galactic nuclei are passively evolving galaxies, giant ellipticals in general. Now, Planck has detected quite a significant number of objects in which this is not the case. The host galaxies have clear signs of being very strongly star-forming. So blazars are not necessarily associated to passive galaxies, but a small but significant fraction of them may be associated to star-forming galaxies. And in combination between Planck and Herschel, it was even possible to produce the first counts at 2 millimeter wavelengths of these objects. And these counts were badly needed to constrain the evolution models and to constrain the statistics of the spectral energy distribution of these objects. I have no time to spend more on that, because I wanted to mention also something about emissions in our own galaxy that were detected by Planck. When we started thinking and predicting what Planck may have seen, we expected to have essentially three types of emission from our own galaxy: the synchrotron, free-free, and the thermal dust. Now it turned out that we have at least 6, which makes the component separation that Carlo mentioned even more tricky, and in fact, maybe the number of Planck channels that at the beginning we thought were sufficient probably or almost certainly will not be sufficient to separate everything. We need to take into account complementary data. Now, there is a complementarity here between most distance frequency ranges. There is a complementarity between Planck and gamma rays. One of the Planck papers have highlighted the presence of what is called the galactic haze, which turns out to be a new component of the diffuse galactic emission, which is probably synchrotron with a particularly hard spectrum. So the hard spectrum means that the relativistic electrons that are responsible for it are not accelerated by the same process that normally accelerate electrons within the galaxy and which are responsible for the previously very well known synchrotron emission, but by something else we did not still know about. I mentioned the complementarity with gamma rays, and in fact the morphology of these rays is in very good agreement with the morphology of the gamma ray bubble observed by Fermi. And this kind of complementarity is extremely useful to help us to understand what's going on there. Another totally or largely, I must say, unexpected component is that of CO emission. There is the Planck high frequency channels are, let's say in this way, contaminated by emission from the lines of the carbon monoxide, which turns out to be pretty strong and to be present in, visibly in at least three Planck high frequency channels. And the maps that have been produced in one of the Planck papers of the carbon monoxide emission throughout the galaxy play a really important role in the study of the star formation and of the galactic structure, as well as in the study of the distribution of neutral gas in the galaxy, since the CO is one of the best tracers together with the H1 hydrogen line, one of the best tracers of neutral gas in our own galaxy. So I think I stop here. If you want, I have a summary of what I've already said in the form of conclusions that you are welcome to read. Thank you.